Thank you so much for taking time out to be part of this very special edition of Blue Sky, this being the first for this year. We will begin shortly. In the meantime, may I request you to all take a seat, settle down, put your mobile phones on silent, and shut off your laptops for the entire duration of the talk, please. I know we have a packed house here waiting to hear from our wonderful guest for today. We will be opening up the floor for Q&A towards the end of the session, so please hold on to your questions until then. I'll prompt you, and the mics will be up front, so you can come up and ask your questions to Mrs. Murty. I won't hold you back any longer. I would like to call on stage Vinod Giri, who is the Vice President for Commercial, to introduce our esteemed guest and lead us into an engaging heart-to-heart conversation with her. Over to you, Vinod.
Thank you, Ambika. Good afternoon, everyone. That's much better. Thank you so much. That just makes us feel like a packed house. Let me just quickly get to introductions. Today, we are going to be joined by a very special woman. She doesn't need much of an introduction, but I think I should cover some of the very awe-inspiring aspects of her life. So let me start. She is a gold medalist in her engineering college. She did her engineering from Bangalore here, and she did her MA from ISC. She did that with distinction. She started her career as an engineer with a company called Telco. I don't know how many of you know that company, but it is called Tata Motors now. She chose philanthropy as her way of life, and she's the chairperson of the Infosys Foundation. Her strong ties to the language and people led her to establish more than 60,000 libraries in Karnataka. I couldn't remember, I couldn't read the number very well, and then I read it again. 60,000 libraries, that's a big number. She also strongly believes in creating awareness for social causes and has traveled passionately traveled all over the world for this, including various gatherings in universities and in countries like US, England, Kuwait, Saudi Arabia, Singapore, just to name a few countries. She's a very prolific writer in both English and Kannada. She has more than 30 books and 200 translated titles to her credit. In fact, I think her books have been translated to pretty much every language in the country. She writes across novels, nonfiction, children's books, travelogues, technical books, and memoirs. She's also a columnist for English and Kannada dailies. Some of her awards include the R.K. Narayanan Award for Literature, the Padma Shri in 2006, the Atimabe Award from the Government of Karnataka for Excellence in Kannada Literature in 2011, and most recently, the Lifetime Achievement by Crossbook Awards in 2018. So, dear friends, please put your hands together to give a warm Flipkart welcome to philanthropist, author, teacher, Mrs. Sudha Murty. Thank you, Mrs. Sudha Murty. Thank you for giving us time today. We're really honored to have you with us today. So without any further ado, can we start the talk with your permission, ma'am? Thank you. I think the one most important area in your world of work has been philanthropy. So may I start by asking you, what got you into philanthropy?
Maybe I was brought up in a village and with a less exposure of the modern world, lived with my grandparents who was a school teacher. Probably they taught me the fundamentals of philanthropy. Love your fellow human being, irrespective of caste, creed, language and gender. And I've written about it, red rice granary, my grandfather. We used to grow two kinds of rice grains in those days, and good quality was always given to poorer people, and in the night we'll eat the red rice. So once I asked why we should eat poorer quality in the night, and whereas people who come for alms and any help, we always give them the best, he said. My grandmother never went to school. She said, God comes in the form of, yachaka. That means one who comes and asks, you should give the best. My grandfather was a Sanskrit scholar. He said, no. They insist, our scripture says, our ancestors have told us, danam priyavak sahitum. Always you should give away the best in you. With the best tongue. With sweet tongue. That is what I think the seed of philanthropy sowed into me when I was 10 years. But the real reason when I started, when I was 45, I have a daughter and a son. My daughter used to read for blind children in Ramana Maharshi Academy for Blind on her own. And she used to write also for them in the examination. She came in the year 1995. She came and told me one day, Amma, I found out a very bright boy by the name of Anand Sharma, who is very good in his studies, but he's very poor. He may get admission at St. Stephen's College in Delhi, and who can sponsor him? I was head of the Department of Computer Science and very busy in the examination time, month of April, and I said, oh, you can sponsor. My daughter told me, you never give money. I never gave money to my children. I always asked, give me your wish list, and if possible, I will try to accommodate that, but I will never give you money. Because you don't need money. What do you need? Why do you need money? She said, I don't have any money. And you say, how can I sponsor? She asked me the first fundamental question, like, Amma, you are well-traveled, well-read, and fairly intelligent. And if you can't do philanthropy, then you don't have a right to say to anyone they should do philanthropy. And that I thought over it over a period of 1 week and decided to do full-time philanthropy. I was sleeping, I felt my daughter woke me up saying that this is my duty. And I always enjoyed. Giving away gives a kind of kick, probably not in any drinks, but a kind of a kick in your mind. Be so happy. You feel nice about yourself. Giving away also makes you much more human. Giving away also makes you to understand your country better. And that has continued. I'm ever grateful to my daughter who woke me up when I was sleeping and made me what I am today. Every day is a holiday to me because I love my work. I never feel like taking any holidays in the last 24 years. I've not taken because I don't need, because every day is a holiday, what you will do? Extra leave. We don't require.
Wow. That's so inspiring. Thank you so much. So, I don't think if I had to go back, and I have children now at the age of 18 and 21, if I were to go and tell them that, look, you don't need money, and why do you need money? They might just stare at me. So I guess I'm learning something right
now. It's not that way. We need money in certain area, and we don't need money in certain area. When they are teenagers, they don't require. According to me, when they are teenagers, they don't require. I always ask them, okay, what do you want? You give me the list. Pen, pencil, book, whatever you want. Give me the list. I will buy. Or I'll come with you. You buy, I'll pay the bill. Why do you want money? For what reason? Or if I give 10 rupees, I will ask receipt for everything. Because money is a double-edged sword in life. And when you are a teenager and your parents are well off, my both children used to tell, press rights that I own this much, you own this much. In real life, not even 10 rupees. Before 18, I never gave. I said, tell me what do you want. You want dress? Okay, I will come with you. Give me a reason why do you need independent money, for what reason? When you cannot explain that to your parents, that means it's not a correct way. That's my argument. Money is required. I don't say money is not required. Money is required to buy a house, medical expenses, your education, you want to travel. But how much you require, that is left to you. For someone, 1 crore is too much. For somebody, 10 crore is much less. For someone, 100 crore is may not be sufficient. For someone, 1,000 crore is probably it's too small amount. How much you require and how much you should own, how much you should keep, and what is excess, is everybody's answer is different. So I will never say money is not important. Your answer is important to you. I was working near Swami Malai in Tamil Nadu about 20 years back, and it was pouring actually one night, you know. It started pouring, and my, normally when it starts pouring, your car gets stuck. I always seen that one, including in the movie. Okay. My car got stuck. And my driver told, you stay in there. There's a nearby temple, you go and stay there. I will get it repaired and I come. And I went there. There was not any hero there. There was a blind man. A blind Vadya and his wife. Blind Archaka and his wife. A blind Pandit and his wife were staying. And he gave me a big lesson in life. I felt bad for him. You know, he's an old man, 80 years, no money. I put 100 rupees and he touched the, he did aarti and he told me, this is too much money. I said, no, sir. You give me your name and number, I will send you 20,000 rupees. It may be useful to you in life because you are old, both of you are old. He said, beta, I don't know who you are, but I want to tell you something in life. Don't ever do this mistake. I said, what? Is it not good to give money? He said, no. If you give money, it is a headache to me because all these days, the villagers look after me. The moment you give 20,000, I put it in a bank or a post, then people would like, I should die one day and they should get the money. They don't even help. What God has given, or Lord Vaidyanatheshwara, I think that temple, I don't remember now. What Lord has given is more than enough. Beta, please remember, in life you have to draw. Enough is enough. And that drawing a line is left to you. And that's the reason I tell everyone, how much you want, I'm not sitting here and telling you 20,000 is enough, 2 lakhs is enough, 20 crore is enough. No, I don't have any right. You are the one which is enough, which is more, and which you do not want more than that. You decide that.
Thank you so much for sharing that. Leading from there, thinking about us as a country where people traditionally have very little, where people struggle to meet their own needs, and of course, needs are aspiring and moving and changing all the time. In these circumstances, if we want to encourage a spirit of philanthropy among all Indians, how could we do that?
You have to think about India's history. Since several hundred years, we have been ruled by rajas, kings, sultans, different people, colonized. There are always, actually, there's the latest book on anarchy. If you read, you'll understand how poor we were in 1757, the War of Plassey, 1857, the War of Independence, 1947, India's freedom. You read all these three centuries, we were extremely poor in 1700. But world's GDP, we share 29%. Can you imagine? And people were poor, but the rich people were extremely rich. Result of that, our DNA has changed over a period of time. We should work hard and save money. Saving money became the motive in life because we never had any backup protection there. There is no plan B. So we have to save all money, and that is the reason we never wanted to part the money. However, always in a society, women always had this habit of giving more than men. Men should excuse me. They always fed some stranger who comes to your home. The lady of the woman always gave him food. There are so many sannyasis roaming around all these years. Where they got food? It's always from the household women who used to feed. So we had habit of giving. But it has improved over last 20, 25 years. The reason is after 1993 liberalization policy, Indians became rich ethically and legally. We started earning money, a lot more. I'm sure many bank officers' children have their salary more than their bank officers' retirement salary. There's so much money in a young age, you got it. And that time, and number of children also reduced. In olden days, there will be 8 children. 8 is normal. 4 is very small family. 12 is big. So in olden days, there used to be a lot of children at home. Resources were so less. Less colleges, less money. So where is the concept of giving away? Because you have to look after your own 8 children, By the time you finish your eighth child, marriage or whatever his expense, you know, you will be end of your life, you will fall sick. So we never had saved money for ourselves. Today, you have one child, maybe two children, not more than that. Parents have built the apartment, child need not work to build a house. The economic equation has changed in 25 years. I have seen in Infosys Foundation, when we work for the natural calamities, it is youngsters who are more magnanimous than my age. Many people have come and given so much of ration, so much of money. I said, I'm so busy, I will write the receipt later. They said, no, I don't want receipt. I said, no, you may not, but I require to account who has given money, the fake money, real money, how do I know? But people come and give money. They want to volunteer. I've seen youngsters volunteer a lot more than middle-aged people. And I also have seen youngsters, when they get married, they bring a refrigerator key, a car key, and give it to me. I said, what can I do? They said, no, my wife doesn't like this model. Ma'am, you better sell it and take the money. So many cars, you know, I become a car dealer kind, you know. And in case I really require money and I send an email to all our youngsters, immediately I can get whatever money I want. I worked 3 months in tsunami. And all these youngsters were with me, batch by batch. I told you, you will not get an extra promotion if you come with me. But you have to apply leave and come, and still they come. They apply leave, 10 days, one batch, 10 days, another batch. Like that, they made almost, you know, 10, 12 batches they made. They have worked with me. So I'm so happy, and I'm also positive that our next generation aspires to be more philanthropic than my generation.
Fantastic. I'm moving to a slightly different topic now. So one is dedicating to the cause of underprivileged sections, but you're also known to be an advocate of gender equality. Maybe a few of my audience have probably read this story, but I think we would like to hear from you when you went to work on the shop floor of a renowned automobile manufacturing company, which is Tata Motors. You wrote a letter or a postcard to JRD Tata. Could you describe us that story?
It is the other way. First I wrote, then I got the job. Not after getting job. I think it is on WhatsApp and internet. I think everyone has read that. It looks like that. No? Is it not that you have read? Or many people have read that. You know, I joined engineering in 1968. And it was unheard in Hubli, a place known as Hubli, someone doing engineering. They felt either my father, we were three daughters to our parents, and my people came to the conclusion that my father has something really wrong, that he supports his daughter who goes for engineering. People thought I'm mentally imbalanced because I'm joining a man's domain called engineering. They used to make fun of me when I used to go to college. They used to make fun of me, saying that, look, that crack is going and all those things. You know. It was not easy, a young girl of 17 years, you know, people talking about you. And, you know, the more they talked, the more disciplined I became. I said, no. You know, what is this man's domain means? Is there something which is really important which a woman cannot do? We used to have smithy, carpentry, welding, everything. In those days, engineering means a complete engineering, not only software engineering like today. You have to do all those things, light fitting, everything. And while I was doing, my colleagues never talked to me because they felt there's a new animal in the zoo. Better. We don't know which side it will turn. So keep them at a distance. They used to look at me, but I realized it is not like, you know, a man can do better, you and I, we can do better. I used to do a better job than them. You know, welding also, I was very good in welding. Carpentry, smithy, everywhere. And you know, in the first semester, I got first rank. That day I realized it's more of an imagination. It's a man's domain. There's nothing like a man's or woman's domain. It's more in your mind. And you can break whatever is in your mind, you can break it. This attitude of mind that you can do whatever you want as long as legally, ethically right, helped me to do my engineering very well. It also made me to write a letter to J.R.D. Tata because I was going abroad. I had 3 fellowships abroad to do my PhD. And I saw this advertisement, women students need not apply for Tata Motors, then called Telco. I felt very funny that even at this age, this was in 1974. It was in 1974. I said, okay, I did not know who was the head of the Tatas in those days. J.R.D. Tata used to come to our institute. He was like a Greek god, very handsome. From a distance only we can see, because after all we are youngsters, students, and never had the courage to go and talk to such people and what to talk. So I just wrote a postcard to him, Mr. Tata, I'm surprised that you are such a progressive person and in your own institute, in your own companies, a woman need not apply for a job. You are paralyzing 50% of the population's strength. And a society where 50% of the people cannot work, that society will never progress and that nation will ultimately will not progress. If anybody would have done, I would understand, but not Tata, because you are always ahead of time. Let it be engineering, let it be in cloth, let it be in salt. Take anything, you are always ahead of time. I did not know his address. I wrote J.R.D. Tata, Telco Bombay, and I posted the postcard. Actually, whole address was wrong. The correct address was the chairman of Telco in those days was S. Mulgaonkar, Sumant Mulgaonkar. It should be S. Mulgaonkar, chairman, Telco, 24 Homi Modi Street, Tamarind Lane, Fort Bombay 1. This is the address. Because it was J.R.D. Tata, it went to him. When he read that, he called his people and said, did you give such advertisement? They said, yes. He said, what a shame. How can you write like that? First of all, you give an opportunity to this girl. See, I come from a doctor's family in a small town known as Hubli. I don't come from a rich family or influential family or political family. I come from a middle-class ordinary family. And I married a middle-class fellow. He became rich later. So, J.R.D. felt sorry because he felt, look at this girl, she is asking a justice, gender equality, and why should we deny? So many people write to me, it seems you wrote a letter to J.R.D. and you got a job, we will write to you, we should also get a job. I never asked for a job, I asked for justice. How can you discriminate a woman and who is well qualified on the basis of gender? Then I got a telegram. In those days, ladies' hostel, phone was considered a very bad sign to have a ladies' hostel because boys will call. So best is not to have a telephone, okay? The only way of communication is only through telegram. When the telegram comes, most of the people think somebody is dead, okay? First, you know, you pray God and then you put a diya in front of Lord and then open this telegram. So this telegram, I got it and it was written there, please appear for the final interview at Pune at our expenses, first class, and such a date. I said not to go, etc. Then my friends told me in the hostel, go, yaar, what is there? And Pune saris are anyway famous, 30 rupees per head. We used to get in those. We'll give you 30 rupees. At their expense, you are going, so you're not spending your money. The first time I got into first class train in my life, I've never seen a first class compartment until that. Got into the train, went there, and then I realized I'm in a really soup because that 7 people are the only candidate to interview. I realized that I will not get this job because they're very upset with me. However, it was a technical interview and I fared very well. Then they asked me, will you join us? They told me why we have advertised, because that time the training used to be in Jamshedpur, which is in Bihar, now maybe in Jharkhand, I don't know where it is. And it was as notorious, Bihar had the same name what it is today, even in those days who had same name. So they said, we'll have Bihar training center and there are no ladies' toilets. That ladies' toilet is always a problem, I think, everywhere. And it used to be in a shift, 6 to 2 or 2 to 8. 2 to 9 actually. So how can you take? Then I told, because I thought I will not take up the job, I was going abroad. I told my interviewer, Dr. Sudha Murty, when a son says, my grandfather was a school teacher, no? So he taught me very well history of India. So I told, when he started to come to India in 629 AD, everyone said, don't go to India, it's very difficult to go. Even today it's difficult to go. And he walked from Xi'an to Kannauj. Everyone said, don't go, but he said, in Chinese language, there's a proverb, for every 10,000 li journey, there's always first step to start. I quoted that, I said, if you want to improve our country and the society, there's always a first step is, you have to hire a woman. Otherwise, the country will not progress. They said, fine, I will give you the job. I did not bother. I went home and told my father, I was very friendly with my father, with a great adventure I did. I thought my father will be very proud of me, but he was very upset with me. He said, first of all, you proved you don't have a brain, because you cannot write to a person like JRD a postcard. You have to write in a band lifafa, at least a cover. Second thing he told me, what are you going to do? I said, no, I'm not taking up a job. I'm going abroad. MIT I was about to go to do my PhD. He said, look, if you really believe what you talk, do you believe? I said, of course I believe. He said, do you believe that women have to be unequal with the men in the workforce? I said, yes, I believe in it. Do you feel that the gender difference is not correct? I said, yes, I believe in it. In that case, you have to take up this job. Because you raise the fundamental question that why women are denied and the job is offered to you, you are going abroad, that shows you are selfish. Depending on the circumstances, you change your policies. If you really respect what you talk and what you mean, in that case, you should take up this job, do well and show them, yes, women are capable. Those were the days where we used to listen to our parents. Those were the days where we never had, it's my life and it's my space. There was no space. Anyway, we were 4 children, so there was no space. So when my dad told me, I thought over it. Then I tore my admission letter and joined telco. The reason is, I really believed in what I talked. I talk what I believe, otherwise I don't talk. So that's the way how I entered into House of Tatas. And I learned a great sense of working for employees, working for the society, to be fair in life, to be magnanimous, to be compassionate. All these qualities I learned there. It is my ultimate university in life, I felt it.
Thank you. So in these many years that have passed from then, how do you see the current state in society today? Do you see equality getting better, opportunities getting better? What's your take? You travel such a lot and you meet so many companies. How do you see women careers in particular?
Academically, when I look at it, yes, women have achieved a lot more, near 50%. In the rural engineering colleges, it's more than 50%. In IITs, maybe 12 to 15%. By and large, women have been educated a lot more. But rural India, it is not the same. I have seen many cases where it's very funny, but it's sad. I can tell many incidents. In rural area, particularly in northern India, I have seen boys will go to English medium, girls will go to Hindi medium. Boys will eat first and girls will eat later. Give her some jewels and marry her off and she is no longer part of your family. It's a lot more there. And women also feel that way. It is not only men do that. Many women have seen, why worry about that? You know, let me be happy. I will not exercise my my voice. People also feel that way. Education is the key which actually makes in a democratic India equality. Without education, it's hard to be. It's hard to be equal. Somebody is earning, somebody is spending. Not money alone. Many times, it's not like my grandmother never went to school, but she was equal. She would tell my grandson, you may earn, but running a house, running the household, and you know, talking to people, keeping the relationship with all the families is equally important job. But by and large, when earning power, a woman loses earning power, most of the time she becomes a subordinate. Or it's not only money, you know, the thinking, your independent thinking is important, and that's what I consider is real independence. Real equality is you should keep your thinking power logically as much as possible, and not because somebody says you should say yes, think for a minute and then you do. Today, things are improving. You should remember, a country where women were burnt in Sati, women did not have any respect. A man can marry many wives and bring, but woman never had that. A country where a daughter's birth is never celebrated, to celebrate, to make it equal requires time. It is not like a computer button, dabao, you get the answer. It won't happen that way. But in the last 50 years, I have seen the tremendous change that women have their voices. Women ask for equality. But I also seen women, I mean, girls should now really, excuse me, becoming more arrogant. In the sense, a new freedom which they got, which was oppressed there for the last 1,000 years probably, suddenly they got the new freedom, then they will say, okay, let me ill-treat the other one, other party. So it also takes some time to die down and become equal. So I feel, and it's in a positive sense, things are changing, but rural India takes little more time, I feel.
Wow, thank you. Coming to the other facet of your life, which is books and storytelling, that's something that you're so passionate about. So how do you choose what you want to write on, what are the characters going to be, what's the plot of the story going to be like, and so on and so forth. So how do you get down to writing a book?
I don't get down. It makes me to write. My story makes me to write. I don't plan anything. I don't write every day 30 page, 10 page, 50 lines, nothing I do. Because of my philanthropy work, I see so much outside. Your imagination has limitation, but the real life does not have a limitation. It's very strange. The more I see, more stories I get, and I take permission from them, then I write. If it's a philanthropy stories or the foundation stories, I think I can write 15, 20 days. Maybe within a month I can write a book. If it's a novel, it takes 3 years for me to write. The story will be in my mind. When the story, and it's always the back of my mind, it goes on, I go on thinking and then the story comes on its own. Every writer has its own method of writing. Like Shashi Tharoor says, he doesn't even think, he starts writing and the characters come to him. That is his way. He's a good writer, very good writer. For me, the whole story will be ready, then I will go on writing it. That is my method. People who are sensitive, they will be able to write better because they vibrate for the situation and creativity comes only at that time. I used to write in school, college, but for the last 20, 25 years, I write a lot more than before because of my work, I suppose.
Wow. If you had to pick one of your personal favorites among the books, which one would that be and why?
You ask your mother, you ask your wife, if you have 3 children or 2 children, which one is the favorite? For a writer, every book is a creative piece and everything I like. But however, writing for such a long time, your writing style goes on changing because you read a lot. A good writer should read a lot, observe a lot. So in that process, over a period of time, I think the writing style and that that knitting of the stories, we call, or weaving of the stories, I think 3,000 stitches could be probably the latest one. It could be the best until I get the new one.
Thank you.
Youngest child is always favorite of mothers. No?
I think the journey of Infosys, and we had a small brief chat before we came here, and this was my personal take, that Flipkart's journey is a relatively similar journey in the sense that both these companies came into a field where there were other companies in the fray, may not have been well known, but they used to be Putney Computers at that point, and there was India Times and so on and so forth as portals earlier. But both of them made a change in the way the world is and so forth. So you've been part of an interesting journey in building Infosys. Anything that comes to your mind that enabled building a company like that? We are a 13-year-old company, and I think we can have a good takeaway in how we can build this company to be, if I may call it, the Infosys in the retail world.
Well, if the founders are male, then I'll tell their respective wives, just allow your husband to work. If the founders are female, then allow their counterparts, allow her to work. Actually, to be a wife of an entrepreneur is not an easy thing, you know. I'm married for 42 years. I know my husband 46 years. Probably we have never taken a holiday. Never taken a holiday. Initially, dearth of money. Later, dearth of time. Now, health issues. Old, no? We're old now. Okay. Overnight plane, well sleep, all those things. What I'm telling is not on lighter side, I told you. To make your company successful, in your generation, it requires a tremendous hard work. Other day, I was seeing a movie. Which movie? Chichore, I think. Chichore. He said, the wife says, you are always busy in a meeting, so I will divorce and go. I felt very strange. You want your husband should be a successful man, build a company. He can't sit in the kitchen and build the company. He can. He has to work very hard. And there is no shortcut to success in life. Whether you are rich or poor, there is no shortcut to success. You have to give away all your time for the company, forgetting your personal things. Then only you can build. A man who builds, he has to be extremely passionate. And a woman who supports him should be more passionate. Because a woman should understand why her husband is working like this than fighting and saying that you are not giving me time. What is there to give time? What you will talk to together after half an hour, you will fight. Let him go to office and work. Better give him more time. So I'm sure all founders should, their wives should understand that. Or youngsters who would like to start on their own, I want to tell you, don't only look at the results. You'll become very famous. You'll have a lot of money. Don't run after money. Money runs away from you. Run after passion. Money follows you. You should always remember that. You work for money, money runs away. Work for a passion, money comes with it. And you have to give a lot more. And it's not only my life. It has been life of Jamshedji Tata's wife, Hirubai Tata. It must be wife of, if you have, anybody knows Marathi here, there's a nice Marathi movie, Harishchandrachi Factory. Okay, it has a subtitle, please see. It is Dada Saheb Phalke's life, what the man, the grand old man of Indian cinema, how much his wife suffered, family suffered, but ultimately he made it. Please remember, when you start any company, any entrepreneurship, there is no guarantee of success. Out of 100 companies, 10 companies can make it. That means break even. One company makes it. Keeping that in mind, you have to follow the passion. I want to be famous and I want to start, then you won't be successful. So I want to tell everyone, work for a passion, excel in your passion. Success follows you.
Thank you. I have one last question for you. And we are in an interesting time. So we have this annual performance development cycle that takes place. And you're required to write about what do you do well and what can you improve? And I think either it is because of lack of imagination or it is the common ailment that every one of us ails with, and we generally write saying, I need to do better time management. And I thought I should ask you that you've been part of such a close-knit family that built a large company. You've been doing so much of philanthropy all through. You've been a prolific writer and you've raised a family so well. In all of this, how did you really do time management?
I really do time management because God is very special. Whether you are rich or poor, good looking, bad looking, male or female, everybody gets only 24 hours. There's nobody who gets 48 hours. You have to manage. You have to prioritize what you want to do. Like, I hardly attend any wedding. Rarely. I consider it's a waste of time. Two of them are getting married. Wish from your home, I feel. That's my way of looking at it. I was a professor of computer science in Christ University. My students get married and now they have also become mothers and teenage children they have. If it is Malleshwaram, I wish them sitting at home. No, I won't come. Even after metro, it takes time. I don't waste time, you know, just like that, whiling away time, sitting there, you know, making a comment. No, I don't do that. I calculate every hour whether I can convert that into any fruitful things or not. Lot of reading I do on my journey. I travel 20 days in a month. And I do a lot more on my journey. And I keep a good habit of walking every day. Every day I walk for an hour or something. And that time I'll think over it, what work I have to do in my mind. I will prepare a checklist. End of the day, before I go to bed, I will check whether I have completed or not. We get 500 emails a day. But as much as possible, we reply on the same day. Don't leave. It goes on accumulating. I get 5,000 invitations to talk. I take a single digit, maximum 9. Not more than that. You have to, otherwise you go on cutting the ribbon, giving a talk everywhere. There's nothing to talk much also, actually. Then when you do your work, my dad used to tell me this joke. His classmate, my dad got a first class in olden days. His classmate got a first rank. So I asked him, what happened to your classmate who got a first rank? Must have been in a good job. He said, no, he failed. I said, how? Because he got a first rank. So people around in Dharwad area, every day somebody will call him and honor him, you know, because some young boy has got. So he spent all his time in, you know, attending all this honoring function. End of the year, he said he failed. And I was a first class student, so I passed. I was an average student, I passed first class. Okay? The man who would have been really bright, he failed and he got into depression, then he became a clerk somewhere, you know. So my dad used to tell me, don't spend time in celebration all the time, attending all these things. You know, it's fun, once in a while it's fine. But if you make it a habit, I sleep at 9:30 sharp every day, got up at 4:30 sharp, irrespective of whatever is the schedule. So you have to be very disciplined. I'm very disciplined. Keep my diary. Without diary, I won't go anywhere. I have my old-fashioned 2 diaries we keep. Because I know time is very, very precious. And I think, at your age also I was like that. But now I've become much more than that. So I'm sure you will learn that is not a difficult thing. But you have to make up your mind. Time is precious. I will not waste it.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. We've had a very interesting conversation. With your permission, if I may announce something that we plan to do as part of our organization,
yeah,
in the world of giving.
Your time up is coming here. No.
Yeah, so the chat time up has come up here. So that's my cue. Yeah. I've been on time for this one, so thank you so much. May I make that announcement for people
fine,
here?
Fine, fine, please, it's thank your organization.
You. Folks, so we are announcing a way of giving and we're trying to create an opportunity called giving through payroll. So the sustainability team led by Mahesh and Catherine are putting together a program that will allow you to pick and choose charities of your choice And it will be through the Give India Foundation, which is a platform that brings together various charitable foundations. The easy method is that you can subscribe through payroll, you can determine what you would like to contribute to whom and where, and so forth, and it will get done in that manner. This is just a way of creating a platform and a mechanism for you to pick your causes that you would like to support. And this platform will be launched very shortly. So please look out for that. And I think, as ma'am said, and some of our people were talking about, the world of giving is all about how you make something out of small contributions that together will create a large, you know, change. So like they say in Hindi, boond boond se sagar banta hai. So that's the point that we're making. And I think, as she talked about, there are so many volunteers that come together, and that's what makes the change happen in the world. So we look forward to you participating in payroll giving as and when it gets launched. So thank you, folks. Thank you, ma'am, for your time.
Can I add something to that? Yes. How much money you give and all is left to you. I don't interfere in that. Mostly, most important is not money alone. Give your time. So, give your time on a weekend, 4 hours per weekend. You know, that is very important. Because in slums, you know, children really struggle, particularly in English and mathematics. Many of our volunteers, they go to slums, teach English. There's not a Shakespeare English, simple English. Okay? Mathematics, it's not like a Ramanujam theory, small one. All of you are so much educated. 4 hours per week, or maybe 10 hours per month. That means 120 hours per year you take out. And do it meaningfully with children. You know, physically you should go and do it. When you work physically, your ideas of poverty will change. Like Henry Ford's granddaughter, was told to write an essay on poverty. She wrote, they were so poor, they had only 5-bedroom house. They had a last year model, T-model car. They had only one cook and they had only one driver. Everybody was upset. But you look at her point. She was Henry Ford's granddaughter. She had never seen poverty. For her, that is poverty concept. And when you go and work with these people, you understand what is helplessness, what is poverty, and what you have. Your cribbing, their cribbing will come down, okay? Thanks to management. What you have, every minute you say, thank you, Lord, thank you, God, you have given such an opportunity for us to be normal, to be educated, and to be in this position. And you'll help people. That's, you know, I was working with a leprosy colony about 18 years back. And I used to distribute saris. One hut I went in and I came out. The lady was without a sari and she never came out to take the sari. I have seen women without sari inside. And it takes some time for me to understand what is the level of poverty people have. Orissa, in 1997 I went and there was a rumor that children are sold and I went to a place and they were ready to give 4,000 rupees a girl. I crashed out and I started crying. That time my mother was with me, she told me, don't cry. Crying is not solution, and then you crying is solution. Everybody will cry, the solution will come. Get up, arise. Don't worry about family, my house, that I will look after. You go to the public life, work for these people, and bring some solace to these people. That means that is the solution. The kind of poverty I have seen, you in a movie cannot describe that much. Real poverty, real arrogance I have seen, real richness I have seen. I have seen beautiful film actresses, ugly people, beautiful mind, ugly mind, big name, smaller mind, small name, big mind, everything, every combination I have seen. And that's the reason I tell you, give money depending on your purse can give. But give time. Time to good organization you go and say, I want to do 4-hour volunteer work. Please do. It is for your sake, not for company's sake. For your sake, you'll be a changed person. I always knew my country, India, how many states, what are the capitals, what are the airports, what is our GDP, etc. Until I started Infosys Foundation in 1996, Once I started working there, went to Arunachal Pradesh, Assam, you name a place which I have not left, and a lot more in Odisha, Bihar. All those places I went, actually I changed myself over a period of time. Foundation was a baby, I was the mother when initially. Later foundation became mother, I became baby. And I'm ever grateful to foundation, it changed me completely in 24 years. I'm ever grateful. No Harvard or MIT would have taught me. My own foundation taught me what is there to share, what is means of philanthropy, what is dependency, what is poverty. All these things what I talk without preparation. I don't prepare and come because I have learnt it from the University of Infosys Foundation. Thank you very much for patient hearing.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. May I invite Ambika take the next one.
Can we have another round of applause for Mrs. Sudha Murty and Vinod Giri? Thank you so much. It was indeed a heartwarming and very, very thought-provoking session. Since we're a little bit running out of time, we'll take two questions. So if you have a question, just come to the front. I've identified one girl here. Sorry, I don't know your name. Just come up, and one from that side. You can go to that mic on your right. She'll ask first.
Ma'am, Kannada dal kelboda?
I can speak Kannada and Marathi both.
Ma'am, elder life alli change annod bande barutte. Neevu ishtella experience madidira. What exact situation made you change drastically?
I'll answer this in English so that other people can understand. And we Kannada people are large-hearted always. We accommodate our guests first. Not one situation that happens in a movie. In real life, not one situation immediately, next day I was a different person. No, it never happened that way. Gradually it has happened, like foundation, gradually I changed. Seeing, working in tsunami, seeing the death in front of me, you know, one limb, one hand, half a body, and you know, it affects your mind. Then I sit down there and then think, what is life? What do I take in life? Is this money permanent? Can money bring happiness? All those ideas, I got it during my work with tsunami. And during floods, in Orissa, I learned that even though the children are very precious to parents, when the flood comes, if the child is suffering from polio, they leave the children and they go. Because there's no time for them to take whatever little they have to run away. And we'll collect all those polio children and put them into a center. Sometimes they come and collect, sometimes they don't. Hard things in life, I learned through my work. And over a period of time, I changed. There's nothing like one has changed immediately. No, it has not happened to me. Slowly I changed. And I feel that is better because you think and change. If you change suddenly A to B tomorrow, there's always a chance B to A can also go back, no? So there's no chance for me, irreversible.
Thank you.
Yeah. Give one chance to boys also all the time, girl. After all, they may be in minority here, so let us.
So, ma'am, all through all these years, I have observed all your talks and your books reflect simplicity. And we all kids of consumerism. In fact, we all are here because Flipkart's here and consumerism thrives. Can you give us all one advice which can make us be more simple, adapt one simple habit to be satisfied with less? Less.
If I do that, then how your business, e-commerce will run then? You have to do e-commerce, Flipkart, people should order and get it. Then only you survive. Manufacturers survive. But individually, I can tell you individually, I have unsatiable greed for books. So any amount of we have some 5-6 libraries at home. So I spend in some other way. I may not spend in this way. I spent it some other way. Well, because I consider myself, there's nothing great about me. And like, you know, I am not number one. I mean, I consider I'm a very ordinary person, and I got a chance in life to do things which I wanted. And that itself is a happiness to me. So other things do not make me happy, like buying very expensive clothes. Doesn't make me happy. So, or buying anything, you know, doesn't make me happy. Because it doesn't make me happy, I remain simple, I suppose. Or more than that, I feel, if you practically think, at least my case, I think this way. If you buy a sari of 7,000 rupees, will I wear 7,000 times? No. It's inversely proportional. It is 2,000 rupees sari, this one. I can wear at least 20 times or 30 times or 50 times. Lower the cost, we use more. That's the reality. And is it not true? Just see. And over a period of time, that desire to own, you know, it's not there with me. Right, from the beginning only, I was not very fond of. But when I saw in my work so many people suffering, you know, they wanted money for some other thing, then I realized, why should I store all these saris? Who will wear? For what reason? My daughter may not like my choice of color at all. Why buy and keep it for her? So I went on analyzing, we don't require that many saris. We don't require that many materials to be happy in life. It's a greed to own. Oh, I have some 20 pairs of chappals. Actually, you use only one pair at a time. If you analyze that, your buying desire comes down. That's what I have done in my life. Actually, I don't have desire to buy anything. Other than, you know, God is not kind, then I have to buy medicine. God is not kind, then I have to do many things. But otherwise, what is there to own and have all those things? How much raw material we use? What we leave for the next generation? All those things, when I think I require, I think it's better to be simple. It's easier to be, easier in life. That's what I feel. It's very subjective. Yeah, please allow one boy to ask question. Otherwise, I feel.
Thank you.
Come on.
Yeah, nobody's asking.
Come up to the mic.
They are scared.
No, we found one boy for you. Don't worry.
Hi, ma'am.
Yeah.
You talked about motivation and following your passion, right? So, when it comes to following passion with you, like I'm working, I have some other passion. How to stay motivated and not getting distracted from so many things we have now, like social media, you know, you get outside and you see so many things. So how to stay motivated and not get distracted and still follow your passion and achieve it? So how do you do that?
This question is asked to Lord Krishna in Bhagavad Gita. How to remain motivated and not distracted? You know, he gave the answer, not me. Yuktahara viharasya yukta cheshtasya karmasu yukta sapnava bodhasya yogo harati dukkha. He said, Krishna himself says, anything you do in the middle path will not distract you. You go to extreme, then you get distraction and destruction. So be in the middle path. Always check yourself. Always check, am I doing wrong? Am I doing right? And look at the goal. You keep a goal and work for it. It's easy. It's very easy if you keep a goal and work for it. If you don't keep a goal, then your mind will go to either to the right or to the left, and it goes on wandering. And to some extent, you know, yoga helps or meditation helps for that, I suppose. These are very subjective things.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Chalo.
Thank you. That was our last question for the afternoon.